Good morning, everyone. Welcome. I want to say a special thanks to Glenda this morning for the wonderful Bach. Thank you. And many of the photographs you've been watching are Glenda's as well. Fantastic. And thanks, too, to Eli Traverse, who's provided a lot of the music that we'll be enjoying. Always a thrill to hear your voice, Eli. This morning, we've had some emails to tell us that Zoom is not having a good day in a couple of regards. There have been some technical issues that other people have experienced. And also the bad guys, the Zoom bombers, have discovered some new tricks. So if anything funny happens, put it down to that. If someone does invade our service, what we'll be doing is simply closing it and meeting for worship at a different time. But let's hope and pray that that doesn't happen. If you're here with us for the first time today, double welcome, and hope that you'll stick around after the service. What we do is we break up into in breakout rooms. Gives us a chance to chat in smaller groups, and you're very welcome to join those. I hope that you've all discovered SpeakerView, one of the settings that Zoom offers. It enables you to have on your whole screen whoever's speaking at any particular moment. And then I'll give you good notice at the end of the service to change back to gallery view, your other option, which will enable you to see all the different faces on the screen. They say that faith is a gift, and I get that. We don't invent it. We could all name the people who have shown us the beautiful thing that faith can be. But it's not just a gift. Faith is also a choice. And that feels very real right now. Stuck on our own in these days of isolation at home, we're learning all sorts of things about ourselves, for better or for worse. It's maddening, isn't it, how few excuses there are these days, how seldom there's anybody else to blame. It's like life is holding up one great big mirror before us. What we see is what we've got. But looking in that mirror, we can see possibility too. One thing everybody agrees on is that this experience is going to change us. So listen for words and songs of hope today. Listen for places you can plant your faith. Listen for stories of what the Spirit can do. Make your choice. The God who chooses us is waiting for our response.
A day of new beginnings, time to remember and move on, time to believe what love is bringing, laying to rest the pain that's gone. For by the life and death of Jesus, God's mighty Spirit now as then can make for us a world of difference as faith and hope are born again. Then let us with the Spirit's daring step from the past and leave behind our disappointments, guilt and grieving, seeking new paths and sure to find.
Let's pray together. Oh God, we're longing for new beginnings. In our poverty of vision, we just pray for everything to go back the way it was. But we know that you are with us in the upheavals around us. Easter is your gift to us to remind us that it is when things look most hopeless that your power comes shining through most awesomely in hope and new life and possibility. So when we get discouraged, Holy One, send us Easter songs to sing. Root that new life in our souls so that we never stop watching for signs of your grace around us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Today we receive greetings from the far north of Scotland, from the island of Orkney, Our speaker is Gabrielle Barnby. Gabby is English originally. She started her career as a scientist, but then life took her in new directions to New Zealand and more recently to Orkney, where she lives with her husband and four children. She's the author of several novels and poetry collections, and I think you'll hear the poetry in what she shares with us.
Coronavirus and the Beacon. Monday at 6:30 a.m. 19th of March was fair in Orkney. Bright blue sky overhead and the flowering currants beginning to blossom. A foolhardy plant to come so early in spring. By the time my eldest two children had caught their bus and my youngest was walked to school, the sky was changing. A short drive to the Balfour Hospital for a routine cosmetic orthodontist appointment for my middle son brought us to revolving doors plastered with notices of new advice about coronavirus. Open for less than a year, the hospital is spacious and spotless. Hands in pockets, not touching anything, we arrive at the dental outpatients. The orthodontist, Mikhail, is a friend from church whose children cross paths regularly with my own. He noted that the morning was very busy, especially with all the extra hand washing. Soon, we are on our way back through country lanes to school. There are no hedges here, everything is wide open. Sea circles Orkney like a prowling tiger. Later, I found out that my son's school leavers show is cancelled and will be performed for the school only before the end of the week. My son didn't seem to mind, but then he only had a minor role. The rest of my morning is spent in deliberate personal isolation. After a quick check on an ordnance survey map online, I head to Rose Ness, a nub of land protruding into the entrance of Scapa Flow, the great naval safe haven between the Orkney Islands. The wind is formidable now, 20 gusting to 35 knots, enough to push me forward as I stand on the mound of a buried Neolithic structure. The summit of the brae drops away to land that sharply becomes steep sea cliffs. I have already crossed bog and watery pools that are peaty and clear, and where in the summer bog cotton will bloom. It is remote from any human habitation, yet there are stoat eradication traps. All are empty, but a line of downy feathers indicate the animals are somewhere near. I walk further on. I want to reach the beacon, a mysterious monument 2 stories high with a cross on top. I shelter in its lee for a moment, then step back out into the blast. The heat from walking quickly dissipates, but I go on further to a small lighthouse, far smaller than the ancient structure, and then I turn homeward. Isolation renews me, fills me with fresh images, and invigorates the senses. On my return, I drop in at a friend's to talk about an idea I have for a poetry and music event in the summer to raise money for charity. I find that she is self-isolating, so I sit at the other end of a long table, and we still talk, but I do not stay for coffee. This is a new thing, something only just starting. Later, at home that night, no longer isolated, exposed to media, infected by statistics and the drama of the changing situation, the inoculation of peace from my walk turns out to be only short term. Today, it is the 1st of May. It feels a very long way from the beacon. Yet it is still exactly where it always was, overlooking the cliffs, where the sea foams and spills, and the wind comes again and again.
The news is actually good in Scotland. New cases of COVID-19 fell by 25% last week, from about 400 to 300. On Orkney, only 2 people have died. But summertime on Orkney is about festivals, music festivals, and art and theater. And one after another, of course, they've all been canceled. There will be no tourists this year, and the local economy will really suffer. So we pray for them as they continue to support one another in their tight-knit little community. Got some great Orkney fiddle music today to accompany us as we share greetings with one another in the chat box. Please say hello and wish each other good health and good cheer. May the peace of Christ be with you all.
We have two readings this morning. The first is from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 43, words that come from the time that the Jewish people were in exile in Babylon. He speaks into their hopelessness with a word from God. I am the Lord, your Holy One, the creator of Israel, your King. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariots and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I'm about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackal and the ostrich. For I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, so they might declare my praise. Our second reading this morning is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8. Again, a word of breathtaking hope. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groaning inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience.
Could be. Who knows? There's something any day, I will know right away, soon as it shows. It make them cannonballing down through the sky, gleam in its eye, bright as a rose. Who knows? It's only just out of reach, down the block on a beach, under a tree. I got a feeling there's a miracle due, gonna come true, coming to me. Could it be? Yes, it could. Something's coming, something good. If I can wait, something's coming. I don't know what it is, but it is gonna be great. With a click, with a shock, funnel jingle, door will knock. Open the latch. Something's coming, don't know when, but it's soon. Catch the moon, one-handed catch. Around the corner, oh, whistling down the river. Come on, deliver to me. Will it be? Yes, it will. Maybe just by holding still, it'll be there. Come on, something, come on in. Don't be shy, meet a guy, pull up a chair. The air is humming, and something great is coming. Who knows? It's only just out of reach, down the block on a beach. Maybe tonight. Maybe tonight, maybe tonight.
Could it be only last summer that we heard Eli sing that for us in person? We knew we were blessed, but we had no idea how much. Eli, thank you so much. That's fantastic. Could be, who knows? This pandemic is a time machine to the future, said one political commentator a couple of weeks ago. Is she right? Will new social policy come cannonballing down from the sky, gleam in its eye, bright as a rose? Who knows? Maybe the most remarkable thing about what we're going through is how utterly impossible it is to predict the future. Our church council needs to do some scenario planning. We're meeting in an hour or so to get started thinking about that. But the best we can do right now is try and imagine our way into a number of really different possibilities, because we have no way of knowing what life will be like 6 weeks from now. Sorry, well, 6 months is what I wrote, but 6 weeks is true too. Back to life, as in normal, like we knew it, is one option. Total dystopia is another option. But more likely, the situation will evolve in ways that we can't foresee from here. So what we need to do is limber up our imaginations and gear ourselves up for choices that may look different from anything we've done before. That sounds exciting. And it sounds terrifying. Faced with that level of uncertainty everywhere you look, you mostly, if you're like me, you take one day at a time. You wait. Something's due any day. I will know right away, soon as it shows. My hope is in those words that Stan read for us about the whole creation groaning in labor pains to give birth to something brand new, because that totally needs to happen. So about a year ago at this time, I wonder if you remember, there was a Sunday when we all got out our phones and we set our alarms on our phones and our watches to go off at 11:11 a.m., remember? It was great, because right at the climax of the sermon, they all went off at once, like a huge wake-up cry for the whole world. The message was that we only had 11 years left to reduce carbon emissions by half if we wanted to prevent the worst effects of global warming. A year has passed, so we got 10 years now. What have we got to show for it but the utterly depressing news that our government is on its way to dismantling 100 of the environmental protections we already had? But then, Did you see it? Somebody took a picture of Los Angeles. You're looking across a park towards the city skyline, and the air is crystal clear. You can see forever. The sky is blue and the trees are green. You can see every window and every skyscraper. It's like a dream, but it's real. We needed an enormous disruption to enable us to get onto a new path. And now we've got one. Could it be? Who knows? With a click, with a shock, phone will jingle, door will knock, open the latch. Some of us have been talking together about how life will be different for us personally. Who will I be as a wife, a daughter, a sister, a friend after this? Who will I be as a neighbor? Who will I be as a citizen? Who will I be as a consumer? I used to go shopping for a diversion, for fun. Now I don't even miss it. The only reason I'll ever need new clothes is if I finally succeed in losing some weight. Because otherwise I've got enough clothes for two lifetimes. And you know what? I never wanted short hair. Once you've got it, it's a mess to grow it out again. You can't go out in public without a paper bag over your head. But here we are, at home. This is my big chance. Only how trivial. While 30 million people are unemployed in our country, that mirror is showing us with excruciating clarity the appalling gap which was there before, the gap between rich and poor, the way everything works against people of color, the way, once again, we are breaking promises to the Native American tribal nations. Only now, doesn't it feel a million times more unacceptable? This is just not the America we want. Those cleaners and drivers and grocery store workers were always essential, right? It's high time they had some financial security in their lives, some hope for their kids. At least we're learning how connected we are, how what happens to one person affects a whole lot of other people. That too has always been true, but we used to ignore it. Now we know. Rich or poor, we are all human, we are all vulnerable. And we all need each other. So we need new ways to be. Come on, something. Come on in. Don't be shy. Meet a guy. Pull up a chair. For me, this has been the hardest week so far. And if this sermon is all over the place, it's because that's how my head is. I know what it is. It's all those voices calling for America to open up again. My whole being wants to scream no. And I get it, how urgent it is for the kids to get back to school. All those people out there, out of work with no safety net, and people watching dreams of different kinds disappearing down the drain. The hopeful young singers and actors who have performed in our church. The bus drivers who've taken us into town. Not to mention the people we can't see, the agricultural workers, those meat packers, the asylum seekers looking at the closed borders. So many people in really horrible times. And how can we lose our school counselors on Mercer Island right now? Think how much we're going to need them. But business as usual is not the answer. It's not good enough. Business as usual is what set us up for this mess. We need something exponentially better. Will it be? Yes, it will. Maybe just by holding still, it'll be there. Isaiah lived a long time ago, and his disaster was different. He'd watched his people rounded up and carted off to a faraway land. Listen, he says to them in their darkest moment, here's what I see. Those soldiers, that army, they lie down. They cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. And God is still speaking. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I'm about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Don't you see it? The air is humming, and something great is coming. So I guess if you come to worship because the sermons are coherent, you might not be back. Please don't come for that. Come because of the stories we tell here. Those exiles got to come home. They got to rebuild their city better than before. And they continued to tell the story of their ancestors, slaves in Egypt, who were led out to freedom. Jesus rose from the dead. We need to seize hold of Easter. Not business as usual, but a God who goes to the heart of the disaster, death itself, and makes everything new. We need that God in our reality right now. Could it be? Yes, it could. Something's coming, something good, if we can wait. What if, asks a pastor from Minneapolis, what if, when the all-clear bell sounds, the buses and trains are still free? Nightly, we applaud healthcare workers, first responders, teachers, and social workers. We say hi to strangers and regularly check in on our neighbors. We link racial, economic, gender justice together, and we work toward the common good. The air is clean all the time. We ride bikes and walk in more places. Another pastor, I would hate for us to waste a good global pandemic by failing to learn what it can teach us about being more fully human and interdependent. We can create a better world on the other side of this adventure if we have the wisdom to know how to do so. I pray we trust this journey enough to let it take us to where we need to go. This one by a retired school teacher went viral. And the people stayed home and read books and listened and rested and exercised and made art and played games and learned new ways of being and were still and listened more deeply. Some meditated, some prayed, some danced, some met their shadows, and the people began to think differently. And the people healed. And in the absence of people living in ignorant, dangerous, mindless, and heartless ways, the earth began to heal. And when the danger passed and the people joined together again, they grieved their losses and made new choices and dreamed new images and created new ways to live and heal the earth fully as they had been healed. It's only just out of reach, down the block, on a beach, maybe tonight. I only know that I want us as a church to be dreaming and praying big enough. We can change the world by our prayers, not least by the power of staking our hopes in God's direction. We hardly need a slide to remind us of the week's news this week. What we need is to remind ourselves that for every story about how terrible things are, there are stories too about new scientific breakthroughs and extraordinary acts of compassion and legal decisions that make the world safer. So this morning, let's pray for the world at large, and let's pray for people in situations close to home. I want everybody to help with this, please. Gather up your hopes. Anything that was sparked by what I shared, your dreams for a new world, and share your heart in the chat box. Let's all do this together. While we write, our song will remind us of the God who is holding us in the face of everything we can't predict. So let's offer God the most beautiful world we can imagine. And if you've got prayer requests for family or friends today, add those things too.
Understand. Then and where, God, from your spirit shall I go? And where, God, from your presence shall I fly? If I ascend to heaven, you are there, and still are with me, though in hell I lie. And if I take my flight into the dawn, or if I dwell on ocean's farthest shore, your mighty hand will rest upon me still, and your right hand will guard me evermore. If I should say darkness will cover me, and I shall hide within the veil of night, surely the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as the day, the darkness light. Search me, O God, search me and know my heart. Try me, O God, my mind and spirit try. Keep me from any path that gives you pain, and lead me in the everlasting way.
Thank you for all the wonderful things that you've written. I need to find a way to make those prayers available to everybody. Maybe we can put them into something we could attach to the email on Tuesday. Thank you so much. Let's continue in prayer together. Oh God, there is pain around us, and we feel it reverberating in your heart. We feel the anguish of your love in the face of the suffering of so many of your children. We are here with you. We feel it too. But we sense your hope as well. We feel it stirring like a possibility in our souls. We sense the mighty power of your Spirit to change minds and hearts. Nothing can stop it, and we rejoice to be your people. We celebrate your life in us, your breath in us, your creativity and caring and compassion, your inspiration, your perseverance, your watchful patience. So we come to you for comfort for ourselves and those whose names we've shared. We come to you for a healing that reaches beyond our bodies into the deepest recesses where hopelessness hides. We pray for a renewal of our spirits so that we can become people of hope, sure about where things need to go, unshakable in our confidence that you can take us there, even if we ourselves don't live to see it. We pray for our leaders and the heavy responsibilities they carry right now. Keep them strong when they are ridiculed or ignored or resisted or defied. We pray for news reporters, so vital to our freedom but so powerful in shaping our view of the world. When everything seems twisted to manipulate our feelings and feed our political biases, come with the fresh air of your truth to make us wise in what we see. We pray again, we pray still for teachers and counselors, social workers, relief workers, health workers. You see their weariness. Refresh them with the living water of your Spirit. And where we are weary, bless us with rest that restores us. Where we are lonely, send signs of your love. Where we are bored or frustrated or fed up, renew our patience. Where we are grieving, hold us. You are our light and our salvation. Whom shall we fear? You are the stronghold of our lives. Of whom shall we be afraid? You have been our help in all the ages past, and you are our hope for years to come. We entrust ourselves to your love in the way Jesus showed us, and as his people, we join together in the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sin, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Finish, we have just a few announcements. Church Council meets at noon today. You've got 45 minutes or so, I think, to grab some lunch and have a walk and such. We'll be back at noon. The men's pub night is especially important on Wednesday because I sabotaged the men's breakfast yesterday. Real apologies to all of you. I didn't realize that it wasn't possible to have two Zoom meetings on one account at the same time. So after discussion, the people running the men's breakfast decided not to reschedule it. They're just going to wait till next month. But do come on Wednesday night and say hi to everybody. Enjoy some time together. On Thursday night, something new. The choir members are going to get together. Singing in the choir is largely about music, but not totally. It's also about real friendships. And the choir members haven't had a chance just to be themselves together for a long time. So choir get together on 7:30. Then those who wish can come and join evening prayers on a different Zoom link at 7:30. Did I say 7:30 for the choir get-together? That's 7 o'clock. And Thursday evening prayers at 7:30. And then to give you notice that in that 2 weeks from today, we'll be having a memorial service for Alan Rumpf. His family has been discussing how we could do this on Zoom. We've got that wonderful video that Alan and Barbara made for our church back when we were celebrating our 50th anniversary, so we'll definitely be showing part of that. But we will gather on Zoom Sunday evening, May 31st at 5 p.m. to give thanks for Alan's life. My final word again is a word of thanks. Thank you so much for your generous support to our church. It enables everything that we're doing to remain possible. Here, once again, is the link. I've noticed that more and more people have been using the electronic link for their giving. That is additional security for our treasurer in precarious times, but also makes things lots easier for you. So again, thank you very much for your generous support of the church. Now receive the benediction. Easter means light in the darkness. Easter means believing in love as our deepest truth. Easter means confidence that life is stronger than death. Easter means watching evil tremble, knowing it has met its match. Easter means joy flowing into every corner of our lives and through us as a blessing to others. Enjoy it, live it, and may the God of risen life be with you, not only now, but tonight, tomorrow, this week, whenever you need it most. May God be with you for Easter gladness and power, today and forever. Amen. Now, everybody, if you want to switch to gallery view. Wow, look at everybody. Let's all wave. Hope you don't think that's hokey. I absolutely love it. It's so great to see you. And I'm going to split us up into breakout rooms. If you happen to end up in a breakout room with Cheryl or with Casey, tell them we said happy birthday.